Is that Dean Marroni?
Hiya, Ben.
Is this the Male Feminist Society?
How's it going? You've seen it, right?
The Male Feminists of Tinder. What a video. And how about that lady, eh?
How about the which one?
How about that lady?
Oh, what? Do you mean the girl doing the video?
Yeah. Oh, it's awesome. I love her.
Yeah. Do you know what? Recently, one of my favourite things, right, is like female conservatives. And also black conservatives, because they're going to say the same stuff that any conservative is going to say, but because they're female or black, they kind of get more credibility and more people are going to like listen without just dismissing them. You know, if it's a white male saying, you know, conservative points of view, they're just going to get dismissed as a sexist and a racist. But you got, you know, and there's a lot. I didn't realize how many, you know, online social media, what do you call them, influencers or whatever, is out there. There's a lot of black people, a lot of black conservatives with kind of social media followings and stuff.
Yeah, I love it. It's absolutely blowing the mold wide open. I was watching Diane Abbott recently with her interview with Owen Jones, and I'm just seeing more than ever. It's like all they've got left is shame. Shame, shame, shame. And it doesn't work on the protected classes, the so-called under threat classes, female, anything black, anything lesbian, anything gay.
Yeah. How do you mean? Like, specifically, what do you mean, shame?
The shame tactics that, you can't say that, you can't have an opinion because... And it's so ironic. This is that the inverted world. It's because you're white, or it's because you're male, or it's because you're from such a place. Like the very racial sexist attacks that they're bitching about being victim of all the time. It's the exact thing they'll use, and it's the exact shaming for who you are. And it's like it just seems to be the core of what the left have got left. Is making you feel bad about who you are. As opposed to anything else, you know, discussing policy, discussing tactics.
Yeah.
Discussing actual progress, just screaming, progress!
Yeah, I don't know if it's in my imagination, but they seem to be more clutching at straws in a desperate kind of way recently. Like, you know, like a few things happened recently. Like there was that MAGA kid, those school kids, right?
Yeah.
And... you know, the ridiculousness and the scandal of that. You know, the kid is stood there smiling, and all he's guilty of is being white while smiling, you know, and there was a hysteria, you know, it was a racist smile, he was clearly having racist thoughts whilst he was smiling, you know, and...
He's not conforming to the shame, that's all it is. They want conformity, that's the number one resource, is human conformity, the human will to bend to them, and that smile just said it all. That smile in that hat was just pure defiance.
Yeah, and then you got the black Israelites
that's
that
were a big problem.
The black Israelites are hurling abuse and threats and just like you only got to imagine if like somebody in a MAGA hat was saying the stuff that they were saying, it would be front page. It would be meltdown. It would be like you know, but
it would still be on the front page.
Yeah, but because it was the black guys, nobody's interested. All they're focused on is the white kid stood there smiling and calling, you know, and saying how terrible that is. And I think it was just so obvious how, what do you call it, biased and ridiculous it was. It like, you know, I think perhaps even people kind of in the middle on the fence could see how ridiculous that was.
Do you ever hear that saying? Jesse Lee Peterson's always saying it, that you become what you're angry at. Right. If you stay hateful and angry as like your mode of being, you eventually turn into the thing you're angry at.
Right.
And that's like the modern left all over. It's they've just become identitarians to the point where they're just completely racially motivated and gender, like the whole world is through that lens that they accuse everybody of being. And it's hilarious to watch the meltdown, and it's just so telling. And so, I don't know. I don't know how long they can prop up the insanity and, and it's not just become a complete joke.
Yeah. 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 That's right. It's hard the good thing.
Morrissey, I've just finished watching a video, the 10 worst things Morrissey's ever said. Like, I don't know if you've noticed, like, in the recent years, they've completely turned on him.
No, I'm
like,
not.
Morrissey
I haven't
now
been
is.
following that. Tell us about it.
Well, you know, a fan of him or not, love him or hate him, he's an independent thinker, and he's controversial for that reason, because he's just not a conformist by nature. And so, therefore, he's, you know, plus being a white male on top of that is a... It's got to the point where the Overton window, the things that are acceptable to discuss in public discourse, it's shrank to that narrow that people like Morrissey, who've like managed to like keep a following and stay popular, not through the mainstream route of being a pop star and appealing to the mainstream narrative, but by just being authentically himself, it makes them absolutely sick. And they've turned on him so pathetically. So, you know, quotes and things that he said years ago. You know, meanwhile, like R. Kelly's running around pissing on underage girls. Drake's like dating underage girls and making music videos with them and saying all sorts of stuff. And then, you know, they're on the front page of magazines.
Yeah.
Morrissey on the front page of hate.com for, I don't know, questioning the monarchy.
Yeah.
It's, yeah, conformity is a, it's a big one, man. I was thinking about my, you know, last time we were talking, and I was talking about my love-hate relationship with sort of showing off and entertaining and that kind of thing. I've been thinking a lot about it since we chatted, and I think I know where it stems from.
Mm-hmm.
It's from school and all that. It's public school, teaching conformity above all else.
Mm.
And at first I thought that sort of entertaining, class clowning and all that was just counterproductive to school. And I thought, well, they do music, they do drama, they do... And then I nailed it. It's conformity itself. Like even in the arts or in the history, they don't teach you why history happened. They teach you to memorize the dates.
Mm.
And fundamentally, it's not so much showing off or class clowning or drawing attention. It's entrepreneurship that they discourage the most above anything.
Yeah.
Because it's the opposite of conformity. And that's what's ultimately not useful to the school system and to the...
Yeah.
Whatever you want to call them.
Yeah,
the
true.
Rulers.
The free spirits and natural leaders and stuff and creative types and trailblazers don't really fit into the school academic model, whatever you want to call it, do they?
Exactly.
It's an indoctrination camp for, you know,
I think
applicants.
There's people who like following rules, and there's nothing wrong with that. You know, they like a timetable. They like. I think that's one of the reasons I'm not into video games and stuff, because I don't like the idea that the next level is just, it's already there and set out, you know, and pre-planned, and there's only a sort of set things I can do within it. And like, I don't think you can teach art so much and things like drama and even music. I mean, obviously you can teach music, you can teach the technicalities and the specifics and the science of music, but the desire to create it and to go in different directions with it and stuff, it's not something you can teach. It's anti-conformity. And it's just not useful at school. And so you get a lot of slack. You know, you get sent to the headmaster, then you get in trouble with your mum.
Yeah.
And over time, you think like, oh, yeah, maybe I should shut up and conform.
Yeah, that's right. And also, like, without meaning to hate on teachers or anything, I'm not saying they're terrible people, but the people that choose to go for that kind of career that end up working in the school and raising the kids are people that chose a safe career path that didn't really want to stick their neck out. You know, they just wanted to... and that's fine, but you're getting raised by people that are not going to understand. If you're that type, as you are, the teachers are not going to know how to nurture that, are they?
Yeah, that's a good point. Like, music teachers, their dream was to be David Bowie, you know. Art teachers, of course they would have rather have been Picasso. You know, math teachers would have probably liked to have, I don't know, been rocket scientists or something. And, it was like that saying that those who can't do teach, can't, I can't think of the word in, but you know the saying.
Yeah.
There's
truth to it.
They're not going to be encouraged so much anything that's not conformity, partly for that reason, because it's not the path they themselves Joel's.
And, you know, and it comes back to that thing with law and force. You know, we're forced to go to school. You know, it's the law. We basically have to go to school. I don't know how it works exactly, but, you know, if you don't send your kids to school, you're going to get arrested or something, I presume.
Yeah, it's weird. I don't know how that works. I mean, I know you can legally homeschool your kids, which I think, I mean, the idea that you couldn't legally home your kids would be insane. But, like, I hear people getting fined and stuff for taking the kids out of school, taking them on holiday. I don't know exactly how it works either, but there's definitely, there is some compulsion behind it.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Some legal force, yeah.
We don't, there isn't complete freedom to choose how to raise your kids, really, is there?
No, not legally, no. I think you can completely go off the grid and be a gypsy, but I don't think you can, no. Get busted. To the indoctrination gulag with your little ones.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, I had a couple of thoughts. Like you were saying just now about Morrissey, and like, it's quite amusing, actually. Like, as the, like you were saying, the range of acceptable things that you're allowed to say and not allowed to say, and political correctness. Like, historic films and historic music and historic lyrics and stuff that, the entire back catalog. Yeah, the entire back catalog of humanity is now politically incorrect and unacceptable. You know?
That's funny. The whole discography of our species is under the interrogation light.
Yeah,
on the torture table.
Yeah, like everything before 2013 might have to just be removed from Spotify, you know, or Netflix.
Oh, God. I mean, man, say it before, but it's so true. Like, the jokes, today's jokes are tomorrow's headlines, man. You want to be careful. We're giving them ideas. Yeah, Prince is another one, man. He's just amazing. And an amazing individual. Because he's, like, in and out of... He's just so in his own world, you know. That's the thing that's I think so admirable about him, and why he was had such a sort of tricky relationship with the media and record labels and what you, because he was, you know, a bit of a gender bender and stuff, and that symbol, and he'd wear high heels, but at the same time he was shagging loads of women and proud of it, a bit of a misogynist, and just a total G. On all levels, and not a conformist, not a mainstream narrative pusher. And
did he express a lot of views about society and politics?
In there's just a lot of kind of, I don't want to say vague, but like nothing about like specific presidents and stuff. But his music is like riddled with like anti-authoritarian, kind of do your own thing. Notions and what have you, and he hardly ever did interviews. There's one where he was talking about chemtrails, and I know he's a bit of a conspiracy theorist and what have you. It's kind of what, as you sort of do an age and look at these things, he floundered a bit and opinions changed, and very much a free spirit. And I think that's what makes him sick. I think that's what they can't stand the most. It's free spirits who get to do that, you know.
Yeah. How much of it has he written books and stuff? Like, do you know about his childhood and that kind of thing?
No. Well, I know bits. I know he was thrown out of, he got kicked out of his house when he was like 14, 15, because he was caught having sex with a girl. And just went mad on music and insisted on producing his first album, playing every instrument on his album, recording it himself, mixing it, mastering it himself. You know, I'm Warner Brothers, and they're like, man, you're crazy. And he said, well, I guess I'll have to go elsewhere. And they folded. You managed to check him out. Yeah? I mean, from an entrepreneurial perspective, he's just like a genius.
Yeah.
And not an evil genius either. Like, it's hard to say exactly, I don't know. I believe in him. I believe he had a good heart and good will. He's not He's persuasive. He's a good marketer. You know, he's not a manipulator. Not a bad guy.
Right. He lets the product sort of speak for itself. He lets his music speak for itself, kind of thing.
Yeah. It's like, yeah, they were constantly wanting to, hey, you need to go on tour for a year and a half to promote this album. He's like, in a year and a half, I'm going to make four new albums. He's almost not interested in, no time to promote. He was just, create, 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 create.
Mm. Yeah,
which
that's,
I just blows my mind.
Yeah, that's interesting, where you put most of your focus on the quality of the product and less focus on promoting it. Because some people are the other way around, aren't they? They kind of create a mediocre product and then put loads of resources into marketing it.
Yeah, man, I fall into that. I can do that. It's a pain. I'm getting more aware of it and trying to, you know, sort that out, definitely.
Right.
I mean, I do. I definitely spend more time creating than I do promoting, but not as much time refining and all that as I should.
Right.
And I was a bit too much time maybe throwing it in Facebook groups and that. Time I could have been spending fine-tuning the product.
Mm. Is Prince your primary influence or inspiration, or is there others?
Probably is. There's a bunch. I love Morrissey. I like The Mask. I like James Bond. I like Donald Trump, John Lydon. Prince is probably the ultimate. Yeah, he's got it all. He's hilarious. He's musical. He's very intelligent. He's a spiritual kind of guy.
Mm. It's interesting how, like, heroes and stuff can, it's sort of like we see ourselves, they're like mirrors for us, aren't they? Like, you know, we see there's probably elements in Prince or in Morrissey that you see of yourself, or there's things you admire that you wish you had more of in yourself. You know, we see ourselves in people, don't we?
Definitely. I think it's like, kind of go through sort of life and childhood and that, and there's like little bits in of you that get criticized and get judged by teachers, society, family, meet, whatever you want to call it. And then you see someone who's killing it, who's successful, who's accepted, who's kind of got that, there's like a hidden element of you that you were sort of a bit ashamed of, and you see a bit of that in whoever turns out to end up being your heroes. Like that bit of that escaped and made it, and you think, oh, wow, cool, it can be done.
Yeah, exactly. I have that with Tyson, and I've got a few heroes. I like following Mike O'Hearn a lot. I sort of admire him. You know the guy, the bodybuilder?
Who's that?
I
don't think I know that guy.
Okay.
I know Tyson, obviously. But...
yeah, he's an American body. But it's like, it's not the person. It's almost like the character traits and qualities that I sort of admire. That's...
yeah.
And I don't know. I'm endlessly fascinated with Mike Tyson just because his tumultuous... story of extremes, you know, extreme highs, extreme lows, everything. Yeah, there's something about that. I don't know. I'm continually fascinated by that. I'm not sure why, even.
Mike Tyson's like, he's like Beauty and the Beast rolling to world. Maybe that's a bad analogy. I mean, he's like the world's most fearsome guy who would, you know, I feel like he would cry if I stepped on a worm.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, like that fascinates me about him. Like he could absolutely fuck up my whole town with one fist. Yeah, I could probably play a song that would make him cry.
Yeah, exactly. That's fascinating, isn't it? Like, because that's quite unusual, isn't it? Because people are either... it's very unusual for, like, a tough guy to be that sensitive and sort of unembarrassed to express his feelings, honestly.
Yeah.
That's a peculiar combination, isn't it?
Yeah, totally. That's the other thing about it as well, isn't it? Like, he expresses his... weaknesses with like such a fearlessness. And it's like that to me. That's the last guy you'd want to fight. That is the most. That's the real menace.
Yeah, it's funny. And like you were saying earlier, like the going back to the people on the left and the way they sort of project, they sort of accuse you of the thing. It's almost like. Yeah, there's some kind of projection going on there, isn't it? It's like they want you to know that they're not a racist and not a sexist, and they're terrified of being categorized as that. And so they make sure that they, you know, very loudly accuse other people of it. So everyone knows they're not those things. There's something like that going on.
Yeah, absolutely. It's classic projection. And it's like, it's one of those sort of psychology 101 things that everyone knows about. You know, everyone knows what projection is. But it's most of politics, and it's just about all left politics seems to have left. Left has left. And it's that, can I remind, yeah, the Mark Twain quote I've just remembered. It's so much easier to fool people than to convince them that they've been fooled.
Yeah.
It's so much easier to sell that narrative to an already guilty, broken population who are looking for ways to redeem the seeds of badness and shame that have already been planted in them. It's so much easier to sell that than it is to hold a mirror up to them and say, you've become the thing that you've been angry at for so long, the very thing that you've been trying to fight and manufacture, even, because it doesn't exist to the extent you wished it did.
Mm.
In the process, you've turned into it, loser.
I heard Steph and Jordan Peterson say really interesting things recently that stuck out. Steph was saying, like, when you believe you're not capable of evil, when you believe you're only good, and you believe that your outlook on life is pure and only virtuous, it's like you give yourself a blank check to just condemn anybody who doesn't agree with you as being evil. And it's like there's something very wise about being able to doubt yourself. You know,
100%, man.
Yeah,
that's like a little bit what you were saying before about the it's not the idols, it's not Mike Tyson, it's not Prince, it's the characteristics they display. It's, you know, because everyone has elements of them that are virtuous and worth pursuing, and also elements of them that are not. And so to make a false idol of an idol or even yourself, it is not. Yeah.
Yeah.
You have to be aware of your blind spots.
Jordan Peterson says the same thing. Like, you have to realize the people in Nazi Germany, like, you have to realize we are each capable of that. We have the capacity to be tricked and enrolled, and the capacity to commit evil within us. And thinking that you're not, not
capable,
yeah,
contaminable.
The thinking that you're uncorruptible and not capable of doing wrong, and thinking that's only other people that were capable of that, is a big mistake. You know, you have to be humble to the fact that those Nazis were people just like us that got persuaded to, you know, kill millions of people.
Exactly. I think it encourages, like, that identity politics sort of shallow entry level, you know, view of looking at the world as well. Because, like, if you think you're not capable of evil and you're not capable of bad things, it's like, it almost, right, individuals don't do it. It's the Jews, or it's the straight white men, or it's the, you know, you have to find the group or the class or the conservatives that, you know, the group over there that's responsible for all the evil. Because the moment you realize that every individual is one, capable of good and bad, and two, therefore individuals are actually a thing, it throws the whole thing into disrepute.
Yeah.
You have to find the bad gang. And it becomes, you know, be it the conservative, be it the white man, be it the straight man, be it British culture. And you become the very hateful identitarian that you thought everyone was.
Mm. I used to think about
the world out here, Ben.
Yes. Oh man, there's so many things I want to say. Like, just in terms of, I can't remember. Did we talk about the Gillette advert last time we spoke?
I don't think we did.
No, I don't think we did. It might not have been out yet. I can't remember.
No, not sure. Yeah. Go on.
I mean, I don't want to sound like too pessimistic, like saying masculinity is under attack in our society. But, you know, it is in many ways. Like, the very essence of masculinity things that have been that is really been, you know, basically men are being told that their natural traits are inappropriate and need to be eradicated and erased.
Yep. And do you know what, Ben? Do you know the big trick that gets me? It's being sold as though this is pro women. Come on, guys, step down. It's women's turn. That's the biggest punchline of all. That's the ultimate evil of it. It's that turning men into pussies is not going to help women. That's not the man women want. And as I think PJW said, a culture that doesn't respect its masculinity is doomed to be replaced by a culture that does. That's how war and that's how life, that's how culture goes. The traditional femininity, the being a housewife, the raising a child, the making yourself look beautiful, that's all come under fire as suspect. And, oh, you're a slave, you're a, turning women into these sort of hideous, man-hating, shaved-headed activists and turning men into these dandelions. And it's like, it's a war on culture because it's a war on family. That's ultimately the root of it. At the minute, it's more kind of leaning towards the war on men phase. And it's the only reason it's being sold and accepted is because it's passable as this is a good thing for women. It's pro-feminist. And feminists are so deluded. They don't know what they want. And what they're advocating for is ultimately going to not leave them in half as good a world as I think they're in now. That's my opinion.
Big mess all that, isn't it? Like,
yeah, man.
I'm not sure if I regret. I feel like somehow I accidentally ended up surrounded by that kind of stuff. But, you know, being in the lefty yoga circus artsy world. But I know we've talked about that before. But yeah.
Do you not feel better for having dipped your toe in, or even your both legs? I don't know how deep you went, but well, I feel like it's like a vaccination.
Yeah, good point. I mean, there is that. At least I feel like I understand the insane asylum now, whereas before I didn't. Yeah.
I think, man. I think it's good.
Yeah.
I look back with fondness on looking back at glassy eyes at festivals and open mouths as I floundered around trying to say something new.
Oh man, I don't know whether to start. But like the idea, you know, I moved out of Bristol and I sort of removed myself from those kind of environments, and yet just being around normal people. Steph makes a good point. Like people that have actually done some work and been to work and had like manual jobs and stuff, they're much more naturally objective and level-headed and down to earth because their job requires that they are. All this fluffy, wafty subjectivism is a luxury of people that have never really done anything, you know?
Right, yeah. It's a lack of discipline. I see that. I agree with that. I'm trying to personally come to grips with a bit more because, you know, one of the things with drinking a lot and et cetera and living just by a lot of my whims is I'm lacking discipline and structure, and it's a bigger problem than I thought it was. Even something in this, I'm sure you can attest to, just something as simple as exercise, you know, having a daily routine of just working out, be it half an hour a day, is helps so much. Clear your mind and organize your thoughts and, you know, feel better and more authentically positive and level-headed.
So where are you at with all that then?
Well, with what?
Where are you at with that? Like, I mean, have you made any changes recently or what's going on with it?
I've just started going to a place we have in Lancaster called Inspire, and apparently they're going to help me with strategies and thinking and what have you to limit alcohol intake because honestly, I was objectively too much, and I tried to cut it down for a long time on my own and said, oh yeah, you know what, I'll have all this today and tomorrow I'll just have none. And I've been telling myself that for so long, it's not been working. So, if you can give me a hand, that'd be good. I'm going to try that. I've been exercising a little each day. My YouTube channel's almost monetized. I've started writing a set. I'm going to go into stand-up again, Ben, after our chat.
Ah, nice.
I'm happy about that. And I've been in touch with a few Lancaster venues, booking some acoustic gigs. Again, I'm still, you know, I'm still floundering. I've got fingers in a few pies, but I have to say I am a lot more motivated and less. All the time I'm feeling less inherent guilt for wanting to draw attention to myself and just, you know, explore and mess about in the world and have fun and make money along the way if possible. Because I'm seeing that's exactly what they want. That's what my enemy wants, is for me to give up and just to stay here and drink wine all day until I die at 32. And that's not what I want.
Who are you surrounded by, like, in terms of your social circles? Are you surrounded by people that are also drinking and that kind of thing?
Yeah. Kind of on and off. I'm not really surrounded. I had a lyric in my song recently. Sometimes I feel rejected, but I just self-ejected. I kind of ejected and isolated myself a bit after the band, so I don't really go out that much anymore. The other night I was hanging out with some friends who I've not... Some of them I've not hung out with like a couple of years. It's a mixed bag. Yeah, there's some drinkers in there and there's some not. I tend to be the prime drinker.
Maybe you need to introduce some new people into your sort of life that are, you know, more, have got more of the kind of lifestyle that you want.
I think I do. Yep. And I think, and I can see it happening. As I go out and do more gigs and what have you and put myself in environments where I feel I'm in my element and I'm doing what I want to do, I think the universe will add on to me people who are up for that, you know, and want to get along and help me progress and vice versa.
Cause
that's one of the things I was thinking about. Like I was talking in the last podcast about a girlfriend and I was always describing it as a goal and... I don't know, I've thought about that, and I think that's totally the wrong attitude. I think when the girlfriend's the goal, you end up manipulating yourself to please whoever she may be. And that's not going to be a happy woman anyway, nor obviously a happy you. I think the way is to do what you do, love what you do, get good at what you do. And the way life should work is then you'll attract someone who's into that.
Yeah, then the right people come along.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I think so.
Yeah, I think so. It's like if you create the environment, like you say, sort of being yourself, being doing what you want to do, then yeah, that like people naturally appear, don't they? That are in line with that.
Build it, and they shall come. It being you.
Yeah, yeah, I agree. I think that does make sense, doesn't it? It sounds right.
Yeah, sounds right. Feels right.
Speaking in terms
of how it pans out.
Like social circles is so powerful because we always end up conforming because our desire to connect with others, whether it's like romantically or just socially, whatever, is so strong that we're going to do whatever it takes to bond with the people around us. You know, if everyone's drinking, we're going to drink to fit in, aren't we? You know, if everyone's you know, doing something else, we're going to naturally feel like drawn to do that, you know? So it's so powerful. I used to notice it. I used to go to this gym called Ministry of Fitness, and it was quite like a serious bodybuilder gym. Everyone there was competing, everyone was preparing to, you know, do some competition. They're all
on it.
Yeah, they're like not elite, like world class. Well, some of them were actually. Yeah, there was like, it was real elite people. They were all sliced. They all looked like cover models. It was great. And like, and also
hardcore.
Yeah, yeah, and because I was also simultaneously surrounded by a lot of circus acrobats and stuff, so everyone's just, like, it was just normal way of life. Everyone's training all the time. Everyone's just, like, yeah, everyone's just exercising all the time. It's just, and just the thought, like, when I think one of my friends at the gym was called Emil, he's incredible. He looked like a world-class bodybuilder, and the thought of telling him that, like, I was hungover or something like that, or, like, I'm going to eat junk today, or let's go for a pizza, like, it wouldn't even cross my mind. I'd be so, like, that would be way too embarrassing and humiliating to say to someone like that, you know, let's go and eat shit for a few hours. Like, it, you know, I wouldn't even do it. And so that social effect is... really powerful. You become whoever you're playing with, for sure.
Exactly. Yeah, no, it's really, really important. And I think a lot of people, here's a phrase I've come to loathe, go with the flow. Like, a lot of people will go with the flow to the extent of their friends, their wife, their colleagues are terminally just what the world threw at them, you know, and never look beyond the job they were offered once they left school, the girl that, you know, first girl that nagged them on, you know, whatever. And you do connect with and become, to some extent, a product of your environment because, yeah, there's no, we're tribal animals and all that. And so your environment's your responsibility. Yeah. And you have to, yeah, try and pick as healthy one as you can.
Yeah.
So was that, you'd say that you think that was good for you, right? Hanging out at the gym with people who were looking after themselves, and that was a benefit to you, right?
Oh, right. You're asking me. Yeah. I think so. Yeah. It was just such a clear example of how I was, you know, becoming the people I was surrounded with.
Yeah.
So, not sure what I was going to ask. You mentioned comedy and stand-up. So, how's it work?
I'm going to do some ghost shows. Hopefully. We're hoping to, anyway. Then what I did in the past, it's basically you get up and you got 5 minutes, which it sounds like nothing, but it can feel like a long time.
Yeah.
And you just basically got to last for 5 minutes. And those that do come on at the end, and they pick a winner out of that. I can't remember what you get or if you get if you win. But what I do, I've done about 10 of those 8 years ago or something. So I had one like 10 or 15 minute slot, which was, man, that felt like a long time.
How does it work? Do you write? Are you in the process of writing material, or what happens?
Yeah. I've not started piecing together like an exact sort of set or material yet, but I know generally what angles I'm going to be taking that, and I've just been accumulating loads and loads of stuff in the back of my mind. So I reckon to write a 5 minute, I could write like a decent 5 minute set in a few days.
Wow. I'm curious to know, like, how the process works. Like, do you take a load of topics that are on your mind, and then, or every time you think of something funny, do you make a note of it? How do you do it?
I'll start with, like, I don't know. For example, like, I might have a blank page, and I'll think of, like, four sort of quips, like, sort of things I've thought of recently that just stood out to me as like good sort of punchlines or good talking points or whatever. Write them down. You know, quips about different things. It's like four corners, if you will. And then see how they connect and how I can transition from talking about one to the other. And if you can fit punchlines in between going from one subject to the other, with sort of the usually sort of three or four main punches in 5 minutes, something like that.
Right.
It's ultimately all quite vague, and you have to allow for it to be vague for spontaneity. But that's a good general approach.
That makes sense because I've got no concept of how it works, but it makes sense to have like a framework structure. Like, you know what your funny punchline hit points are, and then you sort of flesh it out and work backwards, like, and figure out how to lead into it or something.
Yeah, that's a good one. That's all, not exactly how I always do, but maybe exactly how I always should write bars when I'm hip-hop and rap and lyrics and stuff. Sort of the fourth bar will just be this amazing thing that I want to say because it's just a brilliant line. And then the three bars leading up to that are all rhyming with that in mind. You know, so you listen to bar one, bar two, bar three, you're thinking, oh, this is good, and it rhymes. Oh, good, yeah. And then whap, wet fish around the face on bar number four. It seems like, oh my God, and he came up with that at the end, and it seems amazing. Ta-da! But no, I came up with that at the beginning and went backwards.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense.
Like, it's cheating, but it's not cheating.
It's like, I don't know, you do video and audio and stuff, and don't you? You know, sometimes you can line up like a moment in the video, and you can line it up with a like a beat on the song. And so the video's yeah. going along, and then suddenly that moment of action hits the beat or something, and it looks very impactful. And it's the same thing. Yeah. It looks like, wow, that was cool. But actually, you lined up the thing first and then let the pre-roll come in.
Yeah, it's a weird thing in art and stuff. So much of the greatest things that appear like spontaneous often require the greatest planning.
Yeah.
At least the most rehearsal and the most work. Like, I know, like Prince, it was very... Like, as opposed to Michael Jackson, a lot of Prince's sort of on-stage antics were unchoreographed. But so I haven't been doing it that long, you know. I think he was at like 23 and a half hours a day. I suppose it gets to the point where you can be spontaneous, you know, without a script, and it looks as though, like, oh, I wish I could do that. But it's decades and decades of practice, you know.
Yeah, it's sort of a paradox. Well, it's not really, but yeah, like when you... The more, yeah, exactly. Like you just, like it reminds me of practicing skills.
Yeah, because it's kind of the innate sort of drive to whatever in the first place, but you have to hone it. So it's a bit of both, isn't it?
Yeah, I remember practicing scales when I used to play guitar when I was little. I started playing at age 9, and I was really focused on it. It was all I cared about. I just practiced all the time, and I got really good.
Done that. That's cool.
But, you know, once you've done your scales, then that gives you the freedom to be spontaneous. But it's that groundwork that gives you the freedom to improvise.
Yeah. Yeah, that's... Yeah. It gets me every time, and it should. I think that's what it's for. Like, you know, when you see, like, an amazing drummer, and you think, wow, you think, yeah, I can't do that. I wish I had that, whatever it is. But then you look at what it took, and it's like, would I want to sacrifice that many hours of my life to acquire that skill?
Yeah. I was on a conference call earlier because I joined this property investing group. There's 6 of us. And there's a coach. And the idea is we're going to be able to do stuff much easier if there's a group of us. You know, we're going to pool our resources and stuff. It's much easier than trying to do it on your own. But anyway, we were talking about goal setting on the call. And she was saying the same thing. And like, if you kind of start with where you are and decide what action steps you need to take outwards into the future, it's sort of the wrong way around. You need to choose where, like a goal where you want to be in a year from now or 10 years ago and sort of work backwards. Cause that makes sense. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I see. You need definitely. We were talking a little bit about that last time. Totally. Need a vision, you need to know where it's going to end up. You need to be able to visualize it. And thinking a bit between now and that last conversation, I think a little bit, a reluctance in me to make sort of a set in stone plan, if you will, for like 12 months or something. It's because there's always the, you know, then in 12 months' time when I don't meet it, I'm a failure. And so to not have a set in stone goal, it gives all the worst parts of me freedom to be a loser and not achieve those things. Do you know what I mean? It's not a deliberate, it's not a conscious thing, but it's something that I slide into, that I'm starting to identify and tell off, because it's not the right approach.
Yeah, I see what you mean. Yeah, it's good to be aware of that.
You see what I mean?
So it's like, it creates anxiety, doesn't it? Because as soon as you create a goal, then there's the possibility of failing to meet it. And it's like, oh man, whereas if I just don't have a goal, then I can't fail, you know? Cause so in the short term, it's more comfortable.
Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy. Like I've done, I'm mental. I'm trying to figure things out. Like, I caught myself a bit ago in, it was more enjoyable for me almost to wallow in not having a girlfriend than it was to deal with the anxiety of trying to get along with one and the risk reward and arguments and everything that would inevitably come with it. It was just sort of easier and more comforting for me to be pathetic and go like,
Yeah, I understand.
It's all dirty stuff. Self pity. And the reason it's so fucking filthy. It's because it rolls into everything that my enemies want and desire of me. It's all that shit we were talking about before. Anything anti-entrepreneurial, anything anti-conformity, anything that requires positivity and being proud in yourself and your desires and achievements. Anything that's not that, that's shame, that's guilt, that's it's not good.
How do you mean exactly? I don't see how those two things relate. What do you mean?
That wallowing and feeling feeling as though you can't achieve and that you're toxic. That's the big word of the day. You know, that to be positive and to be proud of being masculine and to be proud of things you've achieved and to be proud of who you are is sort of seen as toxic and rubbish. And it's, you know, sometimes it gets me. I fall into it, like the whole, when I was talking about my love-hate relationship with being a glory seeker and wanting fame and recognition for making music and making... It's not a love-hate relationship. I love doing that stuff. The perceived hate, it just comes from the flack you get at school for not being a conformist. And so that's what I'm saying. It's wow, I'm going to use my least favorite word of all time. It's systemic. The guilt, the shame, the self-loathing is in some ways intentionally systemic. And I think that's a good reason to bust out of it and respect yourself and do what's right and take risks. At least that was a good way of thinking and method for me.
Do you mean like his inner conflict? Like if I do this thing that I really want to do, then people aren't going to love me, or they're going to tell me I shouldn't do that, or they're going to reject me, or, you know, it's going to be painful somehow, you know. And is that what you mean?
Yeah. Yeah. Whereas I think most of the things that I've wanted to do, like we're typically swimming upstream, like against the grain. And so, yeah, in a school setting, although it might make the class laugh or whatever, it just always resulted in getting into trouble. But the real world isn't like that. And so, yeah, there's no getting into trouble for exploring creativity. And so, I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm trying to embrace it more and enjoy it more.
Yeah, I can understand. It sounds like whatever that school stuff was has still got... There's the echoes of that still haunt you to whatever degree.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, it definitely does.
Yeah.
It's not something I'm on top of. It's something that, like, I'm recently starting to see very clearly. And I see the way out of it. You know what I mean? I'm not saying I'm there yet, but... I know that I need to go for these things that I innately enjoy, and I'm good with words. I know words. I have the best words, and so I want to make the most of them, you know, and try and use it for the good. And that includes my happiness. You know, my happiness isn't at odds with the good. It's just all obvious stuff, but it's just stuff I'm starting to see and tell myself. You know, it's all good, friends. All for the greater good.
Yeah, it's a horrible feeling when you don't feel it's appropriate to be yourself. Like, I can relate to the same thing, because it's like my experiences with being around hippies. And yeah, because, like, even on the yoga mat, or, like, you know, I've spent time at festivals around hippies and greeny environmentalists, things like that. And, you know, you get chit-chatting, and they're into whatever they're into, you know, recycling their yoga cartons and vegan soup, or I don't know what they do with it. And I can't be myself around those conversations, because I want to be rich. I want to make money. I'm like a business person. You know, I'm flicking through Facebook, looking at the latest Rolls Royce model. That's the stuff that excites me. You know, I'm not rich, but that's the stuff that naturally excites me. And what I really want to say to them is, yeah, you know, I want to do this stuff. And it's not acceptable in those kind of environments. You're going to get strange looks and people aren't going to like it. They want to talk about their yogurt cartons, you know.
Yeah, planting tomatoes, exactly.
And
winter solstice. Yeah, you have to get out of there. Sorry, Ben, go on.
Yeah, so, like, being in environments or choosing the people where they're going to support you in being who you really are or what you want to do with your life is essential, isn't it? I mean, I'm only realizing this relatively recently as well.
Yeah, it's One of the things I was, I've started like doing live streams all the time and doing the news. And one of the things I was talking about was precisely that. Like next time you're in your element, like, or you're doing something you really enjoy, you know, that makes you happy and you're just connected to and confident about, keep an eye on your friends. Check out how your friends are reacting, because you'll see they're in two halves. There's the people that are encouraging you and saying, yeah, go on you, and bigging you up, or constructive criticism. And, you know, the people who've got your best interest at heart, you'll feel that connection and that encouragement when you engage. And then there's a, you know, there's the snarks, the crabs in the bucket.
The crabs in the
It's a
bucket.
real, you know, the crabs in the bucket phenomena, when one tries to climb out the bucket and everyone just climbs up and gangs up on him and pulls him back in.
Yeah.
This it's a percentage of your associates, and it's good to know. It's good to know who's a friend and who's an associate. And it's not all deliberate and conscious, and people that always mean it, but, you know, some people are just going to encourage you and look out for your best interests. And some people are, I don't know, because I think I've spent quite a lot of time being a bit down and depressed. People get used to me as that guy. And so if I was to start becoming not that guy, you know. Yeah, so yeah, I don't know about that.
Yeah, that's fucked up, isn't it? That's gonna keep you. Yeah, because like you
Yeah.
say, that's the trouble, right? If you appease people and be the person you need to be to please everyone, you back yourself into a corner, because then if you have a moment of being yourself and saying what you really think, then all those associates and friends and stuff that you've accumulated, half of them aren't gonna like it, and then you're in this like you're kind of trapped in a way.
Yeah, that Bruce Lee quote. Sorry, man. I do love quotes. I don't mean to be such a cliche head, but I really like when good, broad feelings and concepts are encapsulated in like a few words. Like Bruce Lee said, the right men oh, something along the lines of the right mentality to have is not, oh, I'm trapped in this room with these people. It's these people are trapped in this room with me. I think that's awesome. Yeah, ultimately have to put your you first, you know, in the sense of your interests and desires and the settings, kind of places you're going to put yourself. Conform. The problem with conformity is, where does it end up? What's the ultimate thing that you conform to? If I conform to you, and you conform to people around you, and they conform back to you, and it's like the whole thing that the giving is better than receiving. It's like at some point you've got to sit down and eat your lunch. Like someone gives me a steak, you know, it's like, well, the good thing to do is give away your wealth. So if I give everything away, and then the right thing for the receivers to do is to give it away, and at no point is anyone going to get any enjoyment out of anything because everyone's giving everything away.
Yeah, totally. It makes no logical sense, does it? It's a self-contradicting principle, isn't it?
If the right thing to do is to give away all my wealth, then the person I give it to who then doesn't give it away, by that logic, I've just given all my wealth to an evil person.
Yeah, it makes, yeah, it can't be satisfied. It's a mad standard, isn't it?
Mad world.
Like personally, I have
Yes.
no difficulty. Like when people are collecting for charity or whatever, or trying to get money out of me, I have no difficulty saying no. You know, and if they ask, I say no. I want my money for my future kids. I don't give a fuck about your fucking charity on the other side of the world. I'm gonna feed my kids. People are surprised by that. It's like, what? You want to feed your
Yeah,
own
it surprised
kids?
me.
How dare you? You should. You're supposed to be guilted into sending money to like India or whatever it is. You know, you're not supposed to say no.
What are you, a denier? You deny. Hey, don't get me wrong with it. I think charity is a wonderful thing, and if you've got excess, then by all means, you know, it's a nice thing to give to charity if you feel that it's a good cause and it's something you want to do. That is. That's why I don't appreciate the clipboard people. Do you get those where you live?
Oh yeah, like they're not doing it for the hourly wage.
Yeah, and their boss is driving around in a big BMW picking them up at 5 p.m. or whatever, all paid for by your kind donations. It's ridiculous.
So dishonest, and it is so
My
manipulative.
mate called them human pop-ups. You know, like when you're on the website at the internet and you get pop-ups that you see, you have to X them away. They're like the human real life version of pop-ups when you're walking down the street, you know, going to the shop or whatever. You'll get Excuse me, how can I you've just got to X them. Take me a lot.
Yeah, and it's no different to any kind of sales thing. It's really yucky the way it so blatantly plays on your guilt or whatever, and tries to make you, you know, tries to guilt money out of you. I can't stand that. Yeah. Like, regardless of what the cause is, like, even if it's a legitimate cause, legitimate charity, whatever, I just don't want to be emotionally manipulated into, you know, having my resources extracted from me.
Yeah, exactly. It's the worst mode of extracting wealth out of, or, you know, anything out of anybody, I think. That guilt and shame. That's why I was like more so than, definitely, I think, yeah, more so than I would consider myself, even right-wing, in this current modern context, I consider myself anti-left because of that. It's just so leftist that, like, oh, you should feel bad, people worse off, you know. But it never ends. There's no finish line of it. It's just they've found that white guilt and shame is just a button and lever they can press and push and shove and pull. They just gives money and time and labor and tears and blood and sweat and I don't play that at all anymore.
I was thinking,
at least no. I mean, I'll slide into it emotionally and then slap myself and snap out of it.
Like,
by no means perfect.
You know what I was saying about the male feminists at the start?
Yeah.
Something fundamentally pathetic about that. Like, even if the topics are legitimate, you're still a damn pussy if you're virtue signaling like that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it's amazing. And I don't know. I just think it's... some people have really got no self-awareness. Like, I think some women, you know, obviously must go for it. I think it's like Peterson said, it's the women who've had their relationships with men impaired, like, seriously, like, view any sort of male competence as oppressive. And so they kind of become inverted, you know, like evil wants, like the left wants, they become inverted and go for incompetent losers. Because anything else is patriarchy, right? And, ugh, it's just not good for anybody.
Yeah, Peterson makes a really good distinction with that. Talking about how hierarchy emerges out of competence and people are just presuming that hierarchy emerges out of evil and greed and oppression and nobody's taken into account that people rise up through competence and legitimate work and, you know, problem solving and service providing, etc.
It's all power and corruption. Like, I know a lot of people that feel that way. Like, it's not just the women who've had the relationships with the men impaired thing. Like, I know a lot of men, well, I know a lot of boys that look at that same way. Like, I could be talking about someone I like, or someone who's an idol or whatever, someone I think did well, and they go, yeah, but that guy's like a millionaire. Like that's like, I don't know, like that's a scar on his character or something.
Yeah, right.
You must come across that. Yeah, but I mean, the guy's a billionaire. I'm like, yeah, he's killing it.
Yeah, he's a genius and he's hardworking and he's clever and he knows how to bring teams of people together and he has vision and, you know, and bravery and courage and risk taker and, you know, like, yeah, like, no, there's this weird upside
all
down
toxic things.
Yeah, it's this weird upside down, like, good is bad, bad is good, achievement is horrid, and being impoverished is noble. It, like, this inverted reality, isn't there, that some people have?
Yeah, abortions are fucking radical, suicide's brave, family, what the hell's that, you Victorian?
Social construct imposed by the patriarchy, yeah.
Did you, check this out. This is one of those male feminist of Tinder profiles from that video. This guy called Yoram, who's 30, says, I eat out too much. That's how it starts, right? I eat out too much. In brackets. Not in brackets, but between the lines.
Come with me!
Do triathlons. Play board games in the park. He plays board games in the park. and eat ice cream at inappropriate times.
Oh, crazy.
We're more likely to get along if you're confident, enthusiastic, fun, adventurous, and a feminist.
Oh, man. You know what? This is why one reason why I love watching UFC and boxing. I'm not particularly interested in punching and kicking and all that. It's like, but it's an environment where masculine traits are celebrated permissible. You know, it's like all those masculine traits are kind of expressed and celebrated in that environment. And yeah. I think that's why I watch it. It's just a relief to see men being men without some moaning twat, you know, criticizing it.
I think you just put your finger on. Yeah, that's what I didn't. Yeah, I have a sort of sideline vague interest in that stuff. I watch it now and again when there's a big fight and I really get behind it. And I think you just pinpointed why. Yeah, it's just unapologetic masculinity. It's refreshing, right?
Yeah, exactly. I think that's it, isn't it? And even the press conferences, you know, when you know, you see Conor McGregor or whoever just shouting at each other and threatening each other and saying everything under the sun to each other with no restriction at all, you know. And
it's a glass jaw rat. Yeah. Little rat.
And you imagine being in art college or drama school or fucking circus school and saying half that stuff. You'd be expelled. It's like, he hurt my feelings. He said this thing. I felt it was very inappropriate and misogynistic and, you know.
Oh, man, yeah. You'd be in the naughty corner on the naughty stool with the naughty hat, for sure. And yeah, half of that stuff. That's why I like battle rap, you know. Do you watch battle rap at all? Have you ever got into that?
No.
Oh, man, check it out. It's brilliant. It's like, It's basically the bitchy version of UFC. It's total revered masculinity, but by bitchy, I mean it's all in words and slagging each other off, you know, in words, you know, rather than physical fistfights, obviously. But it's all skillfully done and comedically done, and there's just so many different characters involved, and it's
on the TV.
Yeah, it's great. I love it. No, it's like My favorite league of it is called Don't Flop. If you don't mind, I'll send you a couple of links later, like a couple that I think you might like.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, man, I think you could really get into it. It's so entertaining.
I think that's why. It's like a ritual. Like, there's something. This is why sport and competitive games are important, even if it's a rap battle. There's something ritualistic about going through the process of risking humiliation and competing with someone else and having to step up and just all that, you know, basically be a man, basically. That's what it comes down to, isn't it?
Yeah.
Crucible. That's the right word.
I'm not sure.
I mean, anybody who avoids, you know, high pressure situations or difficulty or challenge or whatever, you know, all those things, they're going to be a problem.
Pussies.
Yeah, yeah, right. Yeah, pussies, yeah. Yeah.
You have to find your high pressure environment. Like, you know, everyone's got their thing, their set of abilities, innate drives, whatever it is. Like, I like words, man. Like, they're my thing. Sort of words and jokes and that kind of thing and performing with them. So, you know, battle rap is one of several sort of high pressure environments, you could call it, where I could be good at, I'm into, and that's something I could do and something I've done and love it again. You know, for the people it'll be difficult construction tasks or management tasks or mathematical pressures. It's not a one size fits all thing.
Yeah, sure.
I don't think I'd be very good at boxing.
I remember Tyson saying, he said so much profound stuff in one of his interviews. He was saying, unless there's a chance of being humiliated, it doesn't interest me. Like, unless there's a chance that I can be humiliated, you know, it's not a great enough challenge, because that risk is the only thing that will bring the greatest out of me. You know, if I don't stand to lose my dignity, then, you know, it's not going to bring the best out of me.
That's such a badass thing to say. Yeah, that's fearsome. That's exactly, yeah. Yeah, man.
Have you done a rap battle?
Yeah, but only ever before I started writing rap, which is so annoying. Like, I did a few rap battles, and then a few months, a year later, I started getting into writing rap, and then I made a couple of rap albums, and I had a band and was a rapper, and, you know, I turned out pretty good. But the battles I did were just after I'd watched a few, and I was a fan of battle rap, and so I watched them with a bit of cringe, unfortunately. Just many years ago. I mean, they were all right. Definitely got some punchlines. But I would like to do it again.
I noticed you've been posting to a page more recently. Is that a recent thing?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, a little bit since we've chatted. And I've connected with a couple of other old friends as well. And, you know, friends, proper friends. And, yeah, a little encouragement can go a long way, man. And I thank you for that. And I just... yeah, I'm just more fuck it in all the right directions. Well, 80% of the right directions, let's say.
That's a good one. More fuck it in all the right directions.
Yeah.
When you think, well, like when I look on, you know, the stuff that people share, the stuff that goes viral, like, it's a lot of it's pretty mediocre. Like, it's okay. It's a bit funny. It's a bit outrageous. It's really snappy and fast paced. There's kind of a bit of a formula to it, isn't there? You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like
short attention span is a big thing, isn't it, at the minute? I know it's like all the sort of viral stuff really caters to instant gratification, you know, no long-winded crap.
Yeah. I know I've said it to you on message, but I feel like if you created a bit of like a brand, just a logo, so there's like an opening, so it just looks like some, I don't know, branded content, like people feel that like they're watching a channel or something.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, I do. I want to do that. Yeah, that's a little bit about what I was saying about I need to spend a bit more time fine-tuning the product before I'll throw it out and promote it. Then that's definitely a good example of it. Yeah, making it more themed, a bit more branded.
Because I remember you did one where it was like, dear white people, and you were like cutting and you were stopping it and commenting, you know, in between everything they were saying.
Yeah, well, I was at a BuzzFeed thing.
Yeah.
BuzzFeed response.
Yeah. I think, like, I like that concept. Yeah. I think that format and that concept works. I think you just need to, like, keep doing it, you know, just consistently keep churning them out.
Yeah, I agree. I got a bit... I got whatever. I got negative. I got scared of them. I got sick of them. I got doubtful of them. And I noticed I did a big chunk of them in about like a month or something, or a couple of months. And I didn't do anything for a few years. And I thought, if I'd have kept doing them all that time, I thought, it'd have got so much better. And what have I been doing instead? Just all the same shit, but in my head. So now I'm starting to do it again.
Yeah.
Do it.
Maybe systematize it so you, like every day you choose like three topics or three news pieces, you know, to riff off of or something. So there's like a, you know, a daily routine to it or something.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I'm, like I was talking earlier, it's the discipline and the structure element of it is what I need to work on, I think, the most. Got the energy and the productivity at the minute, but the systematic approach. Like I'm getting there. Like I've been live streaming the news every morning, and then I'll do like a sort of a quicker, like a little one, sort of in the evening.
Oh, right. I didn't realise that.
Yeah, it's only been like the past week or so.
Okay.
In that. And it's getting better. It's getting more refined. Like I was doing those live streams where I was just sort of rambling, and I rambled myself into a bit of a tornado. But now I'm doing it with the newspaper, which I refer to about 5% of the thing. But it's just something to ground me and look back at, and, you know, some bullshit to pull out of the hat when I get stuck. It's pretty fun.
When you think Stefan Molyneux, he pretty much responds to the news when he does the truth about this, the truth about that. He spent a lot of time covering, you know, whatever was going on in the news,
yeah,
didn't he? And a lot of those will get a lot of views, but it, you know, he puts a ridiculous amount of like. Because it's all very intellectual, isn't it? It's all very thorough, and it's like it's not a comedy thing, so it's a different angle, isn't it?
Yeah, he's a man. He's the intellectual. Oh, yeah, he's incredible. He put so much research and time into fleshing out his perspective before he turns the camera on. You know, you can tell it's brilliant.
But you know that Yeah, I think in principle that works to kind of talk about current events, you know, in whatever format you're going to do it. But, you know, that I think that, you know, that's basically a good strategy, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, well, current events, topical stuff will bring the eyes. And as for the ranting and the stuff I want to talk about, it's all there anyway, because everything that's in the news involves rhetoric, you know, involves some level of propaganda, some level of word wizardry and wordsmithery, and it's just that all fascinates me. So it's all there every day.
Yeah.
Whatever the topic, whether it's Joe Rogan or you name it.
Yeah, yeah. And like in terms of monetizing it, even if you just had a donate just to begin with, like a donate button, like it might not make you rich, but it's just something there where people can give you money if they want to.
Yes, exactly. And that's the thing I've started recently. Like every time within reason, like if I put something out that I feel, I just threw that out there and I put no effort in that, which happens now and again, then I won't put the donate thing anywhere near it because it's...
Oh, you've got that, have you?
Feels rubbish. But yeah, but like when I live stream the news, when I put out music, a thing I've done recently, I have a paypal.me/Marroni.
Oh, okay.
If anyone wants to throw Marroni a bony. That's where it goes down.
Okay, yeah.
So my YouTube channel's not monetized or anything yet, but it's a way.
It's better than nothing. And then, like, somewhere along the line, maybe you create merchandise, you know, maybe there's T-shirts for sale, maybe you got a booking agent, maybe you're available for hire, you know, like, it's just a starting point, isn't it? It's just better than nothing.
Definitely, yeah. It's a starting point. Yeah, merch would be good. I've messed with that in the past. I did I spent half a day making some like T-shirts for the War on Bullshit, and I was advertising them on the War on Bullshit. I can't remember even what they said on them now. It was somewhat cool.
Sell them?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I didn't. I spent about half a day with the designing and the making of them and the promoting of them, and then that's like all I did, and I forgot about it.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's the structure and it's the discipline. That's my new challenge, is to sort of get more professional and systematic about this. It's all well and good being a blabbermouth, but it needs, you know, channeling more effectively and properly. And
yeah,
I'm feeling confident. I'm feeling happy about it. I'm getting, it's coming together. I can see light at the end of the tunnel. It's good.
Yeah. And also, don't be disheartened, like, if something doesn't work. Because, like, with all the stuff I do, like, some of it really works and some of it doesn't work at all. And, like, it's only overall you can really tell. Like, for example, this Sunday, my Leicester handstand workshop sold out. The one in the afternoon in Northampton, I sold one ticket. So, and then,
right,
like, the one in Oxford later that day has sold, like, six or something. So like one of them's a success, yeah. Two of them are failures. And so, you know, like, you know, if you try something it doesn't work, you know, don't judge too much on that.
Yeah, nice one. It's the tapestry in it that counts. It's the big picture, not the individual little failures that make it up. Like the man, I listen to some of I try not to actually, but when I do listen to some of the recordings that I did when I was 15, 16, some of the music and the bands I was in, some of it's really bad, man. Like, obviously I'd just started out songwriting and that, but I mean as in, you'd listen to it and you'd think, this person is not going to be able, this person's not capable of singing in tune. This person's not a singer. But if you listen to this, there was a bit of a madness with that, because I was objectively not, I couldn't sing. But I kept doing it and kept doing it and kept doing it. And listen to the divide and conquer stuff, some of my recent stuff, in my opinion, it's above passable, put it that way.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not Celine, I'm not Pavarotti, but I can definitely sing. And it sounds like something I'd buy, put it that way. It's on a par, some of it, with a lot of the stuff I'm into. And that persistence and that going through failures and making bad recordings and seeing where I do a bad and suffering listening to them and correcting them and again. It's amazing what you can do with hard work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's cool. Well, Hour and a quarter. Is there any burning topics?
I don't really think so. I think I've covered most of the things that were on my mind. I'm good.
Oh, all right. That is the Marroni hour.
Hey, I like it. Cheers, Ben.
Worries.
Pleasure again. Sure, I'll talk to you in the future.
Yeah, all right. Take it easy. See
all
you
right,
soon.
Take it easy.
Cheers.
Adios.